Well, it's good to see all of y'all today. I can tell you've missed each other because we're talking to each other today, right? That's so good. We're going to get started this morning. I'm going to make just a couple of announcements here, and then we'll take prayer requests. If you're a parent here with kids, or you're watching online and you're a parent and have some younger kids, on our website, there is a kids' church service there as well. So if you go to the Watch tab and then down toward the bottom, you'll see the kids' service there for your kids in addition to the service we're having here today. Just don't watch it. Don't let them, well, don't turn over to that instead of us, all right? Keep watching us now and let them watch it on another computer or something. Also, the Lord willing and everything works out right and we don't have any issues or problems with someone getting sick or whatever, we are planning an outdoor night of worship over at the loft on 87, on Highway 87. It'll be Sunday evening, the 27th at 7 o'clock. There'll be plenty of room to spread out. We'll even have the thing set up where you can actually park in your car. If you don't want to get out, you can sit in your car and listen and watch, because we'll run it through a radio station channel, all right? And then also, just bring your lawn chair, whatever chair you want to bring, and we're going to go for about 40, 45 minutes or so on Sunday night, the 27th at 7 o'clock, all right? This month, yes, the end of this month, September 27th, yes. All right, prayer request this morning. I want to mention, let's continue to remember Leslie Cooper, remember Clarence Whitt, and Emma McKinney. You may have some that you want to mention this morning or just by uplifted hand today for prayer request. Janie Brewer, okay. Yes, yes. All right. Before we go to prayer, let me read this scripture here I have for this morning. It's 2 Corinthians 4, 16 through 18, and it goes like this. It says, that is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long, yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now, rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we now see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. That's what we live for as Christians, right? It's not about the present time. It's not about what we're seeing now, but our eyes are fixed on a heavenly home one day that we should all be a part of. All right, let's pray this morning. Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessings, your grace, your mercy, your love, dear Father, you have shown to all of us. Lord, we thank you that we can come into this place this morning to worship you. Father, we thank you for those who may be watching this morning online, Father. And I pray that the spirit that we feel in this place here this morning, they'll feel sitting in their home or wherever they're at today, dear Lord. Father, we just ask you to touch these that we have mentioned this morning in our prayer request. Lord, you know the healing touch that they need. And Lord, we know that you are the healer and you can heal any disease that touches our bodies. And Father, we look to you this morning for that. Lord, I pray this morning to God for the service, that you'll have your way, that you'll do what it is that you want to do in the hearts and the lives of your people. For it's in your wonderful and mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. We're going to do a little bit of worship this morning. And after this first worship song, I'm going to try to go a little old school today, all right? We're going to go a little a cappella on some stuff, all right? So how about stand with us this morning, if you would, as we worship.
Take this offering that I bring, humbly I fall on my knees to proclaim your everything. My life's nothing without you. Take my hand and lead me through. You are my sustaining love. I live to worship you. I live to worship you. So here I am worshiping you with all I am, worshiping you, bowing down in spirit and truth with lifted hands, worshiping you. Take this offering that I bring, humbly I fall on my knees to proclaim your everything. My life's nothing without you. Take my hand and lead me through. You are my sustaining love. I live to worship you. I live to worship you. And here I am, I'm worshiping you with all I am, worshiping you, bowing down in spirit and truth with lifted hands, worshiping you. Here I am, I'm worshiping you with all I am, worshiping you, bowing down in spirit and truth with lifted hands, worshiping you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship. Yes, I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship. Here I am worshiping you. I am, I'm worshiping you, bowing down in spirit and truth with lifted hands, worshiping you. Here I am, I'm worshiping you. with all I am, worshiping you, bowing down in spirit and truth. With lifted hands, I'm worshiping you. Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. Oh, I need thee, oh, I need thee. Me now, my Savior, I come to thee. I am thine, O Lord, I have heard your voice, and it told your love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side.
Father, that is our prayer this morning. Draw us nearer to you, O Lord. Father, we just take a moment this morning to worship and to praise you. There is no one like you, Father. And we bless your name today, O Lord. We give you glory and honor and praise and thanksgiving today, O Father. We lift up the name above every name, the name of Jesus, and we glorify your name, Jesus. Lord, draw us nearer.
Draw us nearer to you, O Father, and help us to be more and more and more like you. In your precious name we pray. Amen and amen. And you may be seated this morning.
Well, I praise the Lord today. Thank you so much for making the effort to be here today. I know by faith that wherever we are, the Spirit of the Lord is. The psalmist asked the question in Psalm 139, where can I flee from your Spirit? So the Holy Spirit is everywhere present at the same time, but I must confess to you, I sense him in a very special way here today. It was just so wonderful to hear some of you singing. Some of you may have a little reservation about singing. You know, the Bible says to make a joyful noise in your heart. I know that. But it also says to speak to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. And some people would say, well, that's just singing to yourself. Well, we've been doing that for a while, hadn't we? Felt good to hear folks sing out loud. I heard this past week something you might be interested in knowing, and that is that songs that contain words that begin with a B or a P, or the more dangerous songs to sing in public, because when you sing a B, baby, you know, or song with a P, party, you emit more aerosols. You believe that? You believe that? So I tried to sing with my head dropped a little bit in case anybody was concerned about the aerosol. I turned a little bit of the football game on yesterday afternoon. North Carolina was playing Syracuse, and as I was watching, I was a little baffled because it sounded like there was a huge crowd assembled in the stands. And they pulled back the camera a time or two, and nobody was in the stands. The bands were not even there. And what was going on is they had a soundtrack of a big crowd of people they were playing during the whole game. And I thought to myself, maybe I ought to get me one of them and have a whole chorus of amens, hallelujahs, preach it, preacher, and going the whole time. Well, sincerely, I am glad to see you here. I read this week that Tom Rainer said that one of the things that you could anticipate after the churches get fully reopened and back like they were is that about 29% of the people that were attending will not be attending again. And I thought that's awful to think that that would be the case. But Crossway's going to be the exception to that rule, aren't we? And you are so faithful, and I appreciate your being here. Others that are watching by way of internet, God bless you. We're glad you're watching. We trust the Lord will bless you, and we miss you. We look forward to you getting back into the services with us once again. If you'll open your Bibles for just a few moments this morning to the book of Genesis, chapter 45, we are working through these chapters, beginning with chapter 37, that deal with the life of Joseph. And sometimes we drop the plow point a little deeper. Sometimes we can just kind of harrow over the land, but there's so many wonderful insights and applications that can be made to us in these scriptures. I think it behooves us to take our time and just squeeze as much of the juice out of this grape as we possibly can. In Genesis chapter 45, I want to begin reading with verse 25, and we'll read down through the book of Genesis chapter 46, verse 7, all right? I'm reading from the New King James Version, and the following is recorded. Then they went up out of Egypt and came to the land of Canaan to Jacob their father. And they told him, saying, Joseph is still alive. He is governor over all the land of Egypt. And Jacob's heart stood still because he did not believe them. But when they told him all the words which Joseph had said to them, and when he saw the carts which Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob, their father, revived. And Israel said, "It is enough. Joseph, my son, is still alive. I will go and see him before I die." So Israel took his journey to Israel took his journey with all that he had, and came to Beersheba and offered sacrifices to the God of his father Isaac. Then God spoke to Israel in the visions of the night and said, "Jacob, Jacob." And he said, "Here I am." So he said, "I am God, the God of your father. Do not fear to go down to Egypt, for I will make of you a great nation there. I will go down with you to Egypt, and I also will surely bring you up again. And Joseph will put his hand on your eyes." Then Jacob arose from Beersheba, and the sons of Israel carried their father Jacob, their little ones, and their wives in the carts which Pharaoh had sent to carry him. So they took their livestock and their goods, which they had acquired in the land of Canaan, and went to Egypt, Jacob and all his descendants with him, his sons and his sons' sons, his daughters and his sons' daughters, and all his descendants he brought with him to Egypt. And I do pray that the Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his word. Anytime I read this passage of Scripture, I cannot help but think about the Beverly Hillbillies. On that particular day in Goshen, Egypt, when carts filled with weary, worn, ragtag-looking people, babies crying, old people kind of slumped over, pulled into Egypt. It must have been quite a scene because the contrast was so great. I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but Genesis chapters 45 and 46 are extremely important chapters in the book of Genesis. In fact, they're pivotal books because chapters, because they reveal to us what happened and sets the stage for everything that transpires in the book of Exodus, beginning in chapter 1 all the way through chapter 14. If you remember, God called Abram from the Ur of the Chaldeans back in Genesis chapter 12. And he said, "I'm going to give you all of this land." It was very, very important that God reiterate that promise. So in Genesis chapter 15, God appeared again to Abraham and he said, "I am the Lord God that brought you up out of the Ur of the Chaldeans, and this land is yours, and you will inherit it as a possession." Well, God certainly knew, and we know that if you're going to have a nation, you've got to have people, and you've got to have a law, you've got to have some kind of culture, and you certainly got to have land to live in. And when God reaffirmed this covenant with Abraham, Abraham took sacrifices and he cut them in half and he laid them open, and Abraham walked between the halves of the sacrifices. And this was a very solemn tradition, and it was something that Abraham did because of solidifying and agreeing to enter into the covenant, particularly the covenant regarding the land. Now, God then said something to Abraham later that same evening. Abraham fell into a very deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, God appeared to him. And God spoke to him, and he said to him in Genesis 15, verses 13 and 14, "Know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in the land that is not theirs, and they will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years. And also the nation whom they serve I will judge. Afterward they shall come out with great possessions." Well, you may at some point in time in your reading through the Scriptures wondered, why in the world would God give Abraham and his descendants the land of Israel, the land of Canaan, and then turn around and take him out of the land of Canaan and prophesy that he was going to put him in a land that he did not identify? And this is an important question, and it certainly relates to us today. And I just want to briefly tell you exactly why that is. I'm not going to be lengthy. Like the little boy was fishing with his father in the surf one day, and They wanted to fish early in the morning when the moon was controlling the tide and the tide was coming in. The little boy asked his daddy, he said, "Daddy, how does the moon control the tide?" And the man said, "I don't know, son. Ask your mama." He said, "Well, I really didn't want to know that much about it." Well, you may not want to know that much about it, but why did God take them out of the land and then promise to put them back in the land? Well, the first reason for that is stated in what God says. He was going to judge the nation that held his people, and he was going to cause his people to come out of that nation in the judgment with great possessions. Well, of course, that was fulfilled. And it was fulfilled in the book of Exodus chapter 12, where we read about the children of Israel leaving Egypt, and they took with them great possessions. You know, the children of Israel were primarily agricultural people. They farmed and grew vineyards and shepherded flocks. And so they didn't have the kind of goods that they were going to need in order to build the tabernacle. Now, if you'd have told Abraham that, he'd have said, "A what? A tabernacle." It would be 650 years after this covenant was confirmed in Genesis chapter 15 before the tabernacle was actually constructed. And they utilized the possessions that they acquired from the Egyptians to build the tabernacle. But there's another reason. There's another reason. This is somewhat obscure, but it's important. Because in Genesis chapter 15 and verse 17, God said to Abraham, "Because the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full." Well, what in the world does that mean? What does that have to do with Jacob and Joseph down in Egypt? Here's what it has to do with. The Amorites were a resilient people, and they were extremely idolatrous. They were evil people. They conquered lands. In fact, the Amorites are the descendants of Noah through his son Ham and Noah's grandson Canaan. That's how the name Canaan land got its name, because of the offspring of Canaan. And God had put Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in that land, the land of Canaan, the promised land, and he wanted them to be witnesses that there is only one God in the midst of people that worship many gods. And they did that, but yet they refused to repent. And God said, "I'm going to extend my mercy toward those people for 400 years, the amount of time in which you're going to be in captivity." I think that is remarkable, don't you? At the mercy and the grace of God, how long-suffering our God is. I couldn't help but think about, well, what about America's cup? You think America's cup is getting pretty full? Well, it might very well be. You know, America has to answer for the multiplied abortions that have taken place, too many for us hardly to even fathom, and some of the things that take place in America today. I think about things that are taking place round about us even as we talk. We talk about things concerning climate change. You know, climate change is actually based on computer projections by scientists. How many times have you heard somebody say, "Well, you don't believe what the science tells us"? You know, you ever heard that? Well, the fact of the matter is, science doesn't talk. People study science, and then they tell you what they think the science is telling them. Just because a person wears a white lab coat and calls himself a doctor or calls himself a scientist doesn't mean that he's going to speak without some bias. We need to remember that. It's kind of like the scientist who took a frog and took him out of a bag and put the frog on the counter and said, "Jump, frog." And the old frog jumped 3 feet. And then the scientist cut the two legs off the front of the frog and he said, "Jump, frog." And the frog jumped 1.5 feet. Then he cut the back legs off the frog and said, "Jump, frog." And the frog didn't move. And the scientist wrote down and said, "A frog with no legs cannot hear." You know, they're having some terrible fires, and I'm not chasing a rabbit, but they're having some terrible fires in California right now. You know, one of those wildfires was set by some folks who were together and set some fireworks off because they were having a gender reveal party. No need to send pink balloons or blue balloons to that family because they really don't know whether they have a boy or a girl. That'll have to be determined later on when that girl or that boy decides what they're going to be, a girl or a boy. Listen to me, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator who is blessed forever. I'm here to tell you that no wonder the reason is God has given people over to a reprobate mind, not being able to stand the test. Well, the Amorites' cup of iniquity was not yet full, but God was watching it as it arose. And then over in Numbers chapter 21, we find that God's people drove the Amorites out of the land. Well, one of the things that we've been noticing as we've been studying the life of Joseph is that God has been providentially working in the background, doing all kinds of things to set them up so that they would find themselves in the land of Egypt. And last week we gave consideration to the fact that Pharaoh's resources were made available, and then we saw Joseph's request, how that Joseph told his brothers that he wanted them to go with great urgency and tell his father that he was alive and wanted him to come down to Egypt because he had been made the governor over all the land of Egypt, and the Lord had blessed him and God was working in his life, and it just seemed like that everything was just fitting together. Isn't that the way it is when you serve the Lord? You can look back over your shoulder and you say, well, the Lord was just fitting all of that together. I didn't see it then. I didn't understand it, but he was fitting it together. And so now we come to Jacob's response. And the first thing that I call your attention regarding Jacob's response is this. Jacob is struggling. He's struggling. Look again in verse 25. Then they went up out of Egypt and came to the land of Canaan to Jacob their father. And they told him, saying, Joseph is still alive, and he is governor over all the land of Egypt. And he believed them not. That's quite an interesting statement. You know, Jacob's boys had come home. You got to remember that, you know, Jacob had not seen his sons in probably 6 or 8 weeks. He sent them all down to Egypt. Simeon and Benjamin were already there. He didn't know what was going on with them. Were they dead? Were they alive? Was he ever going to see them again? See, he didn't have an iPhone so he could text and send pictures, and they didn't have Facebook so that everybody can say, hey, see, we're eating breakfast at the Shoney's buffet today. Yeah, they couldn't do that kind of thing back then. They couldn't call each other. And so as far as Jacob knew, his sons might be dead. He didn't know. I'm confident he was glad to see them all when they appeared before him, and he was no doubt really happy to see Simeon and Benjamin in their midst. And he probably wondered, you know, why is it that you got on new clothes? Did y'all go by the men's store while you were there and get everybody some new clothes? And he didn't know what was going on. And the Bible says that he didn't believe them. He didn't believe them, even though he saw that. He couldn't believe the words that they spoke. I think it's important for us to take a moment and try to draw some conclusion as to what kept him from believing. I mean, the Bible says that when he saw them and he heard those words, he said that the Bible says that his heart grew faint in the King James Version. And the New International Version, the New English, or the New English Translation, it says that Jacob was stunned. And then it says in the book of the same book in the New English Translate, or the English Standard Version translation, it says that his heart was numb. You know, it's possible that Jacob might have had a heart attack. He was an old man. He will confess in chapter 47 to Pharaoh in verse 9 that he's 130 years old. That's a little older than some of you and a lot of us, amen. But he was a feeble man. He was old, and it might have been that he had a mild heart attack when he heard those words. It's not impossible. Perhaps you heard about the man who was a World War II veteran. He had been a good friend to someone who he was a soldier with, and he actually saved that soldier's life in combat, and then when they got out of the service, they lost touch with each other. This man was now a very, very old man. He was a godly man, but his friend, whose life he saved, had gone on and established his own business and opened up business change, and he was so ever grateful for the fact that his friend had saved his life in combat that he left him in his will $1 million. And the children wondered, how in the world are we going to tell Daddy this? We don't want him to have a heart attack. He's already got a weak heart. So they contacted the preacher, and the preacher said, well, I'll talk to him. I'll try to be tactful. And so they got around to talking, and in the course of the conversation, the preacher said to the old father, he said, suppose you were to inherit $1 million, what would you do with it? He said, well, I'm an old man, preacher. I got everything I need. I've already got my will set. I'm leaving my children all of my land, and they're going to be well set. He said, I guess what I'd do is give half of it to the church so that y'all could build that new building you want to build. And the preacher died with a heart attack right then on the porch. Jacob said he wouldn't believe. Why? Why? Well, I'll tell you why. Because the thing that happened to Jacob happens to you, and it happens to me at times in our lives. You see, what was going on with Jacob is this. On one side of his soul and spirit, the tug of war began where reason and faith wanted to believe that. But on the other side, he had the tug and the pull of imagination and fear. I'm confident if you can remember when you first started believing in the Lord Jesus Christ and accept Him as your Savior. Now, if you're fortunate to have been raised in a Christian home, you may not remember when that took place. But if you were not, at some point in your life, you remember when you came to the point of believing. And it might have just been news that to you seemed too good to be true. You mean to tell me after all I've done in my life and all the terrible things that I wouldn't want my mama to know about, there is one named Jesus who can forgive me of all of that and never remember it against me again, and it can be under the blood? Well, that just sounds too good to be true. I just find it hard to believe. Some people feel that way in the initial stages of their hearing the gospel. Some people feel that way after they have been walking with the Lord for some time. The Lord may be asking you to do something. He may be directing you to do something, and you're thinking to yourself, well, reasonable. It's reasonable to know based on Scripture that God is trustworthy, and if God is telling me to do this, then I ought to do it, and I ought to step out in faith. But then on the other side, you've got all this imagination. Well, suppose this happens, and suppose that happens, and suppose the other thing takes place, and this doesn't come through, and then you find yourself with fear. And you're either going to walk by faith or you're going to walk by fear. A double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. He can't walk in faith and fear at the same time. I suppose most of you are aware of the fact that when I became your pastor just several months prior to that, in fact, about a year before that time, I had both of my knees replaced. I get around on artificial knees. Titanium. Thank God for it. But a few years after I'd been your pastor, I suffered an unusual occurrence. I started having severe pain in my left knee, and I went to the doctor and had him check it out on a Thursday. The surgeon that did my knee transplant had tremendous confidence, faith in his ability. And he told me, he said, in 28 years of surgeries, I've never, ever seen this before. Your kneecap has come off of that artificial joint, and it's moved to the side of your knee. And I said, well, what can we do about it? He said, we're going to have to correct that. And that was a Thursday. And I said, well, when do you want to do it? He said, this is an emergency. I'm scheduling you for surgery on Monday morning. Well, Cindy and I came on back home. And Monday morning, I had to be at the hospital at Charlotte at 6 o'clock. So I was up about 3:30, and I was shaving, getting ready to take that shower with that special soap they give you, you know, before you take your surgery. And all of a sudden, I did something that I probably haven't done in my entire 66 years of living. more than five times that I can remember, and that is I got nauseous. I got sick, and boom, everything just came up in the sink. It was awful. So I got it all cleaned up, and went ahead and got my shower, told Cindy about it, and we got down to the hospital before 6, and when they were getting me prepped for my surgery, my surgeon came in. I had great confidence in his skill and ability. I had faith in him. I told him what had happened. He said, well, you probably got a bug of some sort. And reason told me that that's probably true. And then I had my imagination to get stirred a little bit. And I thought to myself, well, suppose while I'm on that operating table, I get sick again. And I aspirate my lungs. I have a pulmonary aspiration. And, my daddy died. That was part of the reason for my daddy's death. His lungs aspirated because solid contents got down in his lungs. And then I got fearful, and I told the doctor, I said, I am afraid to go through with this. He looked at my chart again, took my temperature, and he said, oh, don't worry about it. I'm going to take care of you. And he did. And I had the surgery. Well, when you look at Jacob doesn't believe. As a matter of fact, when you look at his life in chapter 37, you find that he receives the blood-stained, torn coat of his son Joseph that he had given to Joseph. And it is Jacob who comes to the conclusion and lives his life based on the assumption Joseph is no doubt dead. I mean, he doesn't even send a search party out looking for Joseph's remains. He just assumes that some wild beast got a hold of him, tore him all to pieces, and killed him, and he was content to live on that lie. He is not the bastion of faith and happy talk if you read Jacob's life. As a matter of fact, when Pharaoh meets Jacob for the first time over in chapter 47 and verse 9, he's saying to Jacob, tell me a little bit about yourself. And Jacob said, well, I'm 130 years old, and all of my years have been evil and difficult. Kind of looking for pity for himself, don't you think? Well, that's kind of his mindset, you know. He's always looking on the dark side. And so he's not one who's going to have great faith to begin with. We don't see that operating too much in Jacob's life. Did you know? The Bible says that God is the God of Abraham 281 times. Did you know that the Bible says that God, the God of Isaac, that phrase appears 166 times? But when you read the God of Jacob, it appears 309 times. I want to tell you, that does something for my heart. Because all of us know that there are times in our lives since we have started walking with the Lord Jesus Christ, there have been circumstances that have overtaken us, and we just begin to wonder, can I really trust God in all of this? And I know I ought to trust God, and I'm going to believe God and follow God through this. But then, imagination and the fear wants to kind of creep into the equation. And you think, well, maybe I don't know. Maybe this will not work out like I want it to work out. And we find ourselves living in that same place where Jacob lived. That's why God is the God of Jacob. Because Jacob's God is my God. Jacob's God is your God. Do you dare to claim that you walk in faith all of the time and never doubt, never fear, always trust, always have the happy talk, always look at the silver lining behind the cloud? Not many people can be that way. That's why our God is the God of Jacob. Jacob He just lived on that assumption that Joseph was dead. He lived his whole life there on that assumption for 22 years. And now all of a sudden this crowd of well-dressed boys come into his presence and they gather around him. It doesn't say anything about they broke the news to him gently. They just said, "Daddy, Joseph is alive and he is the governor over all of Egypt." No wonder it took him by such great surprise. But isn't that the way it is in life? Some news is just too good to be true. I think about the disciples on the way to Emmaus in Luke chapter 24. Think about this. The Bible says in the 9th verse of the 24th chapter that they are held up, huddled up, hidden with the other disciples because they fear the Jews. And the women come barreling into the house where they are hiding. And they say, "Jesus is risen. He is not in the tomb. He is alive." And you know what they do? They get up their belongings and they head on back to Emmaus. Jesus appears to them and they say, "Well, you know, we kind of hoped that he was going to be the one that we could depend on. He was going to be the Messiah. But they said, he's not in the tomb and now we just don't know." Jacob struggling. Can you identify with that? Then Jacob steadfast. Notice what the Bible says now about Jacob. "But when they told him all the words which Joseph had said to them, and when he saw the carts which Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob, their father, revived." Now, most of us, when we came to know Jesus, again, if we were raised in a Christian home, it'd be very, very difficult for us to go back and mark that time when you first believed. But Joseph sent his brothers on a mission with a message. And he equipped them with everything that they were going to need to accomplish that mission. And it's certainly true of us when we are saved. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10, that we are the recipients of the grace of God. We are recipients of the gift that is given to us at the time of our conversion, a ministry gift. And he says, "Therefore, minister it as good stewards one to another of the manifold grace of God." And so what we learn here is that everything that they needed to go and talk to Jacob and fulfill the mission and bring Jacob down to Joseph in Egypt, they had what they needed. What did they have? They had words. They had words. Not just their words. But notice that the Bible says they told him, Jacob, everything Joseph said to them. And of course, that would include the previous verses in verses 14 through 19 when Joseph is saying, "Listen, this has all been God's doings. I can see it just as clear as a bell. There's no need to put yourself under condemnation. God's had a hand in all of this. God sent me before you to be a savior, to preserve your posterity. God sent me down here to make me the governor. Now I'm Lord of all of Egypt, and God has made me just like a son to the Pharaoh." But in the 18th verse, when Joseph has revealed himself, the Bible says they hugged one another's necks, and they talked together. Now, what do you think they said during that conversation? They hadn't been together in 22 years to know who each other were. You think they talked and caught up about their families? "Well, how's your wife? She's doing good. How many children do you have now?" "Oh, I've got seven. I've got seven children." "Wow! How about that niece of mine? I bet she's pretty as a doll." "Oh, she graduated from college last year. She's married. She's working down at somewhere." "You're kidding me. Well, what about our neighbors? What about the livestock? What about Daddy? What about the time Daddy did this for me?" You see, they had words. They were convincing words. But Jacob still had trouble believing. As a matter of fact, I think the more they probably talked, even though their words were rich with a ring of truth because Joseph had said it, it wasn't moving him much. What was it that caused his spirit to revive? What was it that caused him great hope? Was it not It wasn't that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word. It was what he saw. What he saw. You see, we can tell people what we want to tell them as long as we have breath to tell them. But people need to be told and they need to see. I'm not talking about signs and wonders, although they certainly do occur, and they occur in third world countries far more than they occur here, because the American people have a church and a restaurant on every corner of every little hamlet, city, and town. And the fact is, we don't need a whole lot of great convincing. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, verse 39, that an evil and adulterous generation seeks a sign, but none will be given to it except the sign of Jonah. And then he said to Thomas in John chapter 20, verse 29, you have seen and you believe, but blessed are those who've never seen yet still believe. What was it that moved Jacob? It wasn't those 20 donkeys. 10 male donkeys filled with all the good things of Egypt and the 10 female donkeys with all the food, things that they were certainly going to need. I'm thinking to myself, and I read and I studied and I looked for, why didn't Jacob get moved by the sight of those donkeys? I suppose if those donkeys could have spoken like Balaam's donkey, they might have said, hey, what about us? Can we not convince you? Look at all these goods and all this food that we brought up this way for you. Didn't faze him. What it was the wagons. When he saw the wagons, his spirit was revived. And I want you to notice this, because it's easy to slip over this if we're not careful. And I got to go in a hurry. My clock has stopped. You can't beat an iPhone when you really need it, can you? The Bible says in verse number 28, then Israel said, it is enough. Joseph, my son, is still alive. I will go and see him before I die. It was something about the wagons that were connected to the words. And I think the spirit in which they were talking and seeing the wagons at the same time was a great testimony. You know, the Bible says that believers are the epistles of Christ, and the testimony of Christ is written upon our hearts. And we can go around and tell people all day long about how much we love Jesus and how much Jesus loves them and how the Lord's going to work it out. But what people want to see is the evidence of what we say in our lives. And you'll notice that Jacob said, no, Israel said, it is enough. Joseph, my son, is alive. I will go down to see him before I die. In other words, what's going on here is that three times in these verses of Scripture, you find the name Jacob, Jacob, Jacob. That was his given name. The name means a supplanter, one who assumes the role of another, one who is a trickster. But it was in Genesis chapter 32 when Jacob was going back to his homeland, and he had to meet Esau, who he had cheated out of his birthright, that Jacob said, by the river of Jabbok, the angel of the Lord appeared to him and wrestled with him and changed his name. And he said, you shall no more be called Jacob, which means supplanter or trickster. You shall now be called Israel. And the name Israel means a prince with God. It means one God who overrules, God who is in command, God who is sovereign. And Jacob, his life was changed that day. He had a limp that he walked on because the Lord had touched the hollow of his thigh, took his hip out of joint. He couldn't go see the orthopedist, and so he walked for the remaining days of his life with a terrible limp. It was a testimony of what God had done into his life. Now, on the one hand, you have Jacob. Jacob, who is at times kind of a poor mouth, self-pity. I remember my daddy, when we were growing up, sometimes my daddy would get sick. A lot of times my daddy would say he was sick. He wasn't really sick. What he wanted was attention. Now, you probably don't know anybody like that. And my daddy would either feign or be sick, and he would want sympathy from my mother, my brother, and me. And he would say, you know, the Yateses don't live long. Well, his daddy died at 80 and his mother died at 94. I think that's probably long enough in some circles. But here's the point I want to make. You can be Jacob, who is sort of vacillating in his faith, his walk with the Lord, kind of whining, wanting self-pity, feeling sorry for himself. Or you can be Israel and know that the Lord your God is in command and control of everything. Never forget this. God is in control of your circumstances. For God makes all things work together for good to them who love him and who call according to his purpose. And God is also in control of the consequences of your circumstances. So we identify either with Jacob, we identify either with Israel. So Jacob is struggling, and Jacob now becomes steadfast. Israel said, I believe it. My spirit's revived. I want to go down and see Joseph before I die. And I think we'll just leave Jacob right there today. You think that's enough about Jacob today? We'll pick this up next Sunday. Let's stand together, please. Lord, our Father, in the name of Jesus, you know us infinitely. You know us intimately. There's nothing about us, O Lord, that you do not know. You've searched us, Lord. You know us. You know our thoughts afar off. There's not a word on our tongue or thought that races through our mind that you do not know altogether. We fathom, we marvel at the fathomless mercy and grace that you extend to us, and we thank you for your great patience with us. Help us, O Lord, in our times of walking with you, times when we find ourselves struggling. Help us, O God, to be steadfast. Help us to remember the words that we have heard and have read in your word. That faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It divides and makes the distinction between the spirit and the soul, the joints and the marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of our hearts. And God, help us to take note of the wagons every day. For it is the goodness of our God that leads us to repentance. And you've said in your word in Psalm 68 that you daily load us with benefits. We know that every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. God, help us to be thankful for the wagons that are our families, our friends, our health, the ability to work and acquire the material possessions that we have that makes life more enjoyable. God, help us never to forget, so that we too might be steadfast. Help us to model our lives after Israel and not so much after Jacob. But thank you, God, when we are either, for continuing to love us and not break covenant. We ask this in the name of Jesus, for your great name's sake. And everybody said together, amen. Thank you again for being present. How many of you were able to get my Wednesday night study this past week? How many of you heard it? All right, well, listen to it this Wednesday. It's good. It's good. Was it the one that you heard? Was it the one on the, it slips my mind right off hand. If I can't remember it, I can't expect you to. All right. But we'll replay that this Wednesday night. If you haven't seen it, the majority of you haven't, based on your hands not being raised. Watch that, and God will bless you for it. All right? Next Sunday, the Lord tarries, God wills, right here at 11 o'clock. Come on back and join us. We look forward to seeing you then. Have a blessed day. God bless you. You are dismissed.
Speaking truth when I can't find it. Just the clouds he rides, swing low, lift up the sound as he makes.
makes our praises true. Behold the Lord, our God, will lead us worship. Empty words I can't.